All right, we are recording, and I'm excited. I've got Robert Breton on the podcast today. Do you go by Bobby at all, or Rob, or just Robert?
I did growing up. My grandparents called me Bobby. All my uncles and aunts called me Bobby, and then I'm Robert now. My dad was Bob, so I feel like I'm going to graduate into Bob when I hit like 40 or 45.
Yeah, I was just curious because you always hear like, the actor Robert De Niro, but I guess his close friends call him Bobby or Bob or something. So I'm like, oh, I always thought it was Robert, but
yeah, I like it all, really.
All right, cool. Well, I'm excited to have you on and get into it about detoxification, spirituality, yoga. We'll talk about your new book. And there goes my dog barking, of course. It happens every single time. Well, I get a water delivery coming today. And I think I got some packages coming, so she's going nuts. But all right, that's all good. So, all right. So, well, thanks for coming on the podcast. Thanks for coming on, share a little bit of your time. So I kind of want to get into a little bit of your backstory, because I don't know a whole lot about how you got into this lifestyle, what the catalyst was for you to get on this journey. So I'm just curious to get a little bit of your backstory. Where did you grow up?
So a little town called Orangevale, California. It's close to Sacramento, the capital of California.
Oh, is it? Okay, I'm in Livermore. That's not too far away.
Yeah, not too far away at all. Right now, I'm in Southern California. But yes, just love California, born and raised there my whole life. And it wasn't until, standard American diet, just growing up totally just in the standard America, and rewards of fast food and just the general emotional attachments to food and everything growing up. And it wasn't until I kind of was out on my own, growing up, like probably 17 years old is when it got really intense for me, in the sense of my digestion and just my whole life was being controlled, honestly, by my lack of being able to just digest food and assimilate nutrients. And going through the Western route, I was diagnosed with irritable bowel syndrome at 16, and then my parents didn't know what to do. Nobody knew what to do. This is back before, none of this was cool. We're talking over 15 years ago. I'm now about to be 31 years old. So this is, before all this, even the word vegan was around or anything, people were just vegetarian back then, and it was like an exclusive, thing. It wasn't like a health thing, so I didn't have any resources. So what I had to do was really go within. I was in college at the time, and really I was just in experiment mode, like cutting out wheat, cutting out dairy, cutting out meat, cutting out just anything, what I call now trigger foods, that really was triggering inflammation and triggering all these problems. Yeah, yeah. And fast forward a little bit, I took a yoga and meditation class, 4 semesters in a row, because I just totally loved it. I really felt in tune with what I was doing in my meditation practice. And a couple years go by, and I just have a really solid meditation practice. And I can remember the story like it happened yesterday. I had this true empathy, this true realization that all the anxiety, all the stress, all the discomfort in my life was coming from the animals and the choices that I was, consuming these products that were not aligned with my energy and what I wanted to do. So that realization happened in the blink of an eye, and that was it for me. So it was something where, yes, it started as the health thing, and I was in daily pain for over 3 years, couldn't hold down a job, going to the bathroom 6-8 times a day, convulsing, like literally. I'm so lucky right now I don't have Crohn's disease or serious ulcers in my digestive tract. I think a lot of people right now are walking around, maybe even 70-80% of the population, with, leaky gut and issues, digestive issues. Yeah. They think it's normal. When I was a kid, I thought it was normal. I was just walking around, and I genuinely thought that, coffee and fast food and just that stuff was just the normal thing. And that's what I did, and I love my parents and everything. It's one of those things where I made that mistake of blaming them in the beginning, and we're all on our own journey, and I have that courage to just go within through the meditation practice. And, my intuition really just started to become awake. I was able to, discern between that, voice that was just saying, eat the Cheetos and eat the cheeseburgers, and transition to more just whole foods, which now, thank God, 15 years later is popular and is like actually getting some momentum. So that's why I created the Infinite Cup. That's why I created everything, recently in the last few years, because, I was just traveling, doing my thing growing up, after college, really went to Alaska and explored just places that are, free. and wild, because at the end of the day, I was really tired of, you know, my lifestyle in California, and tired of that whole rat race, and tired of the just the relationships that I was in, and that constant stagnant energy. So
yeah.
I got certified as a yoga teacher in 2011. And I didn't have the intention to, you know, like become a teacher or have a class or anything. It was just really furthering my own, you know, spiritual progress, really an evolution. And it's funny looking back now, because I'm just, again, so thankful for my meditation practice and things, because I feel like that's my anchor. That's what roots me in this world right now, especially yeah. current times where it's just ex-vegan drama and blah, blah, blah. It's really, you know, gotten crazy, in my opinion. And it's because people don't have that foundation. You really need to, you know, root yourself in something that is just, you know, resonates with you. It doesn't have to be yoga. It doesn't have to be that, but something that is, you know, greater than yourself, something that you feel, you know, drawn to really aspire to. And that's honestly what gets me out of the bed every morning and just makes me excited about life and to be able to share, you know, techniques and protocols to others on how they can achieve their best optimal self. So it's really been a full circle for me, and tapping into iridology, tapping into the different things that I've really learned to kind of learn to master, in the sense of how can I really harness this ability to help others in the best way that I possibly can.
Yeah, awesome. You used the word intuitive a couple times there, and so it sounds like you really got in touch with your own feelings, and it's what they call, you know, living in internal opposition. If you're doing things that you know you shouldn't be doing, that's going to be a real mind effort, you know what I mean? So it sounds like you're really conscious and aware of that, and I think I am too, and I'm not perfect by any stretch of the imagination. You know, we all do it. That's just being human, but if you're constantly living in internal opposition, going against your values, your morals, that's going to, you know, like I say, thoughts can be acidic. And if your mind's out of balance, your body's going to be out of balance. So I think that's a huge portion to it. And that's where, like you said, the meditation comes in to really balance you out mentally, emotionally, spiritually. So that was cool that you figured that out at an early age. You know, some people wait until their 40s and 50s, like me. I didn't get into this until my 40s. And finally, it clicked. I'm like, what am I doing? I can't live this way.
Yeah. I was forced to, as you can see. I mean, looking back.
Yeah, pain's a good motivator.
On the surface, you know, our physical pain is what opens our heart, you know, to these things, like raw foods or meditation even. Like, I talk to people and it's such a foreign concept to them, you know, and for me, it's just an everyday walk of life. And I understand that. And I'm very thankful, because I was that person too. And I had all these blocks, and it's the thing where, you know, learning how to surrender and how to let go and how to just have a simple, you know, day-to-day peace of mind is something we all want. So at the end of the day, it's just a matter of how are we doing that? And then, you know, going down the rabbit hole of karma and things, because I think a lot of people, when I really got into raw foods and just like the health movement, I saw a lot of toxic people, you know, and they were really focused on just the food. And I was too for a long time, and I was a fruitarian, and I would call, you know, I was like walking around and telling people that, you know, cooked food is bad and all these things. And it's like you go through the vegan police for, you know, a few years. It's an evolution, and it's awesome. You got to embrace it. It's just one of those things where, looking back, it's like I did a lot of harm, and I did a lot of, you know, I judged a lot of people for no reason. And it's something that pedestal is something I don't want anything a part of. You know, I really think it's unnecessary. Yeah. And the, you know, because of social media, maybe now because of the power of social media, it's just automatically gets put on a pedestal. And I understand that. So it's funny. Like I said, for me, you know, creating the infinite cup, I always want to circle back to just, you know, spirituality. What practice, you know, gets you in tune with that higher source? We don't have to get religious and call it God or Krishna or anything. Right. We just have to, you know, really hone in on these bigger questions. Like, you know, who are you? Where did you come from? What is your purpose in life? What are you doing on the, like, for me, I honestly feel so excited talking to someone like yourself, because you're in this movement too. You're tapped in, you get it, you know? And it's this, you know, evolution that we're all on together. So it's a matter of helping that message and promoting it. And it's something we can use the power of technology. And I admit I was avoiding it for a long time. I was the guy, you know, traveling. And I was like, I didn't have a phone, man. I feel so bad for my mom and stuff looking back, because bless her heart, she was so worried worried about me, you know, traveling to Alaska, doing all this crazy stuff. I didn't have a phone or anything. And because I was Mr. Anti-Technology and, you know, so it's like, it's just really funny because looking back, it's like, if I would have started my YouTube channel like 10 years ago, oh my gosh, like I have no, I just like, you know, what would have happened? You know what I mean? It's just funny.
You got to be the digital nomad. You can be a nomad, but you got to be a digital nomad. Yeah.
I'm embracing it. And it's funny how much work I do though to counterbalance the effects of technology on my body, though, for real, you know what I mean? Like, even like here in the city, especially because I'm used to living on farms, you know. I was just recently on a citrus farm for over a year. When I travel, I just love nature, so that's like my main, you know, destination and focus. So right now we're you know, in the big city in LA, and it's something where I'm here for reasons, and I'm happy to be here. It's just I'm absorbing, you know, a lot of, you know, electromagnetic frequencies and a lot of things, you know, toxic emotions from people and a lot of things that I have to deal with on a day-to-day basis, you know. So that's really the yogi path. That's really something that I, you know, aspire to do, because the only way out is through. And I did my time yogi in the woods. I meditated for years, and I just, you know, was very solitude. I didn't go to the store or anything, and I just lived off the farm. And I really felt like, you know, that was my place in previous lifetimes. But in this life, I really need to be in the city, be where I can, right in these front lines, man. Let's put the gloves on to the ex-vegans in a non-compassionate, loving way. Yeah. And, you know, really, you know, just go circle back to nature, back to these things that have always been here this whole time. At the end of the day, that's kind of what's funny to me is, you know, man can't reinvent the wheel. It's not going to be, there's no new thing, you know. Trust me, as a farmer too, like my first job was picking peaches and plums when I was 14 years old. Okay. And I know the industry, I know what's happening with, you know, GMO and this worldwide epidemic we're in right now. It's very troublesome, you know, and it's something that I feel, you know, calling more than ever to really uphold these values of health and nutrition and fitness, because people, you know, are really just looking on the surface, that artificial surface level, whether it's their abs or things like that, which is great. It's fine. We all want abs and to look good, but yeah. I want to get deeper. I want you to think. I want you to, you know, think about your water. Where is it coming from? Who are the people growing? Can you name the people growing your food? Do you even know that person? Do you even know where it came from? What state? I mean, these are questions that I think need to be addressed in the day-to-day life. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we're so disconnected at this point. You just don't think about that stuff. And we're so, you know, got our face buried in these things that it's the stimulation. It's the external stimulation. It's, you know, we want that instant gratification, and we just don't think long-term, because that could lead to stress. That could be stressful, and it's stressful doing the hard work. It's not easy living this lifestyle, right? I mean, it takes practice. It takes work, and people just don't want to do it because, again, it's stressful.
Not the easy road at all. And that's something, you know, the story with the Infinite Cup, how it came up too, and I'll just tell it real quick. It's short. I, you know, I have an old, you know, teacher guru. We're all teachers, by the way, and we're all students. I learned so much from you and your podcast and what you've been doing. And I think we're always going to be students and always have potential to find teachers in everyday circumstances. So an old teacher of mine, he really came up and he's, you know, just talking about fruits and vegetables, love and life. And he's like, you know, Robert, your cup is really big, but it's not infinite. And I was just like sitting there like, wow, you know, it just hit me. And it was like, wow, you know, I think that's what we're all aspiring to, this infinite cup, you know, this something. And it really brings that old cliche of like, you know, is your cup half full or half empty? Right. Yeah. And it's like, I don't want either of those choices. I want an infinite cup. I want to be, you know, this body right here is very temporary and very, you know, just a very tiny glimpse, a percentage of the reality that we're experiencing right now. So yeah. I think a lot of people just, again, are looking on that shallow, you know, artificial surface level. And then, you know, in yoga, we call this Maya. It's illusion. It's literally an illusion. And if you can, you know, wake up to that idea, you know, and really experience that and not read it in a book and not, you know, just watch somebody on YouTube or whatever, but take these ideologies and mythologies home and practice them, and just see what happens, you know, because that's what I did so long ago. Again, because I had such a heart-opening experience through my health, I had to dive deep into this stuff. And then now, 15 years later, I'm happier and more excited than ever. My body feels great with iridology. And I'm not perfect either, like you, with iridology. I'm working some soul out. I'm working on issues and I'm challenging myself and I'm growing. That's the thing, though. People are sweeping their problems under the rug. And I just don't have the tolerance for that. I don't have in my energy fields, you know, like it happens every day, but like when you come into my energy field, it's like, I just don't have a tolerance for that. I want to be that mirror and I want to show you, you know, where you're at and how can we talk through this and really help each other, because that's what we're here to do. And we don't have any, you know, time to waste. I mean, this is precious. This lifetime, this body, this thing, this vessel that we have right now is so precious. And people, I think, just don't understand that. And it's something where, I mean, I, you know, obviously did things to my body in the past that I'm not proud of. I didn't drink alcohol or anything crazy or, you know, too much. But I'm just saying we all have things that we did in the past, right, that harmed our bodies. And we find where that balance is, you know, to kind of where we lie. And that's kind of what we do as human beings. I'm just talking about circling back to, again, those questions like, you know, who are we? Where do we come from? And what are we here to do? What is your purpose? Because when you ask those questions, it's like that light switch, you can't turn it off. So I try, and trust me, I've tried to go back.
You can't.
It's like, it makes things way worse than it totally is.
Yeah. Well, it's like, it was exactly like the movie, The Matrix. You know, take the blue pill or the red pill. Once you take that red pill, you can't go back. And I've always kind of said this lifestyle has been a blessing and a curse for me. Blessing because I know the truth now and I can do it, but it's kind of a curse because, yeah, you can't go back. I mean, once you have the information, the download, that's it. So you got to be careful what you let inside your head, man, because some negative stuff can get in there too. So I'm really particular and picky about who I watch on videos or who I follow, because they could lead you down some dark roads. You don't want to get that in your head. So
true. And it's very powerful, but you're talking about the subconscious. And it's so powerful every day. And the crazy part is, I don't want to get too conspiracy or government, but
go for it, man.
Well, I'm just saying, I have that side in me, and we can go on a tangent forever because, you know, all this information that we're talking about, you know, other human beings in higher powers know about it too, and they're using it against us. I mean, that's obvious to me. So
I don't have to get into
who or what, but I know that as a fact. So it's something that, whether it's the chemtrails or blah, 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 you know, I mean, we can address it how any way we want, but it's very much truth, and that, you know, they know it's powerful and they're using that power to keep us in control. So that's very much obvious because of the food system, because of the air. I mean, I have to drive hours right here in LA to go get spring water, like literally just water. See what I mean? Like the system is designed to keep us sick, and it's something that people have been, you know, it's sad, you know, holistic nutritionists and people have been disappearing for this reason. And it's something that I've learned to just, you know, be conscious of my words and my language, because it's something that, you know, big brothers out there. And it's one of those things that we just have to be mindful of. And, you know, back to The Matrix, you're totally right. And it's funny because that movie's almost like a documentary to me.
Exactly, yeah.
A lot of Hollywood, I think, has like the consciousness, because we're all one, the consciousness is there. So the Hollywood scene is very much, I think, like forward, and they kind of instill like the, you know, Star Wars mythology or something in before people accept it, and then it becomes norm. Yeah. So it's kind of fun to see that with The Matrix, because a lot of people use that lingo. I love scripture, and I love, for me, I've always just kind of thought about with food or just, you know, fitness or anything, I ask the questions of like, you know, what did our ancestors do? What did we do 5,000 years ago? What did we do back then? You know, because that, you know, structure, bone, you know, blood, lymph, everything we got is pretty much the same, you know, 5,000 years ago. The only difference is our environment, technology, and different things, right? So those questions really just get me excited. And it's one of those things that fascinates me with the evolution of just the human being and then what we're doing, and then circling back to our evolution of the soul. Because when you have that realization, that's really where we can start, you know, asking questions and going down, because I think that's what we're here to do. And that's not what's being addressed in this, you know, vegan community and this health community. And that's where I feel that calling more than ever, because that's where I want to start, you know, because all of that other recipes or vegan debate or this, it's like, no, it's like, I don't have time for that, because it's not serving the greater good. And it's just, it's like backward steps, you know? You know, in yoga, it's basically a time, you know, a time circle. And we're, you know, if you picture time like as this, an evolution, we're on this upward ascending, you know, time right now, and it's exciting. And the dark ages were really dark, and man only lived to, you know, 40 years old if he was lucky. And now it's like man's living to 150 plus, no problem. You know, it's easy. It's very common in just a few hundred years, you know? So that's what I mean. It's something that we really need to, just comprehend, right? And just really be able to evolve as a species and you know, stop worrying about all that little stuff, you know? Is when you ask these bigger questions, these light bulbs just go off in your brain, you know? And the, again, circling back to the biggest thing for me, it's just that meditation practice. Because in the beginning, you're asking about meditation intuition. I didn't have that forever. Like I said, I was going to McDonald's every day and and doing things, you know, very toxic things to my body that I'm not, you know, proud of. But looking back, I had to do those things in order to become, you know, who I am today, and I'm very thankful for that. Right. So if not for those experiences, I would be doing them right now. The midnight runs to Taco Bell until, you know, I was working in the restaurant industry for years, man, so stressed out. And I've always had this passion for food and this passion for health, you know, throughout this whole thing. So it's been a blessing and a curse at the same time. Like I said, I wish I could go back and just like go eat pizza at some restaurant and just relax and just drink like everyone else and just la-di-da. But it's really, it's just not possible for me anymore. So I've learned to just channel my energy into the infinite cup and to really, you know, promote as much positivity as I can, because people are just lost right now. And I get it because I was lost too. And I really found myself through this practice. And that's the other thing too, is I don't want to be this macho person on some pedestal. I want to empower others to awaken their intuition. Because if I were, you know, thinking about one word right now, it's discernment, right? It's like, can you discern between that voice of that intuition and the voice that says, give me the, you know, Oreos, or let's go out tonight, or let's jerk off, or whatever, you know what I mean? Like there's a lot of voices in there that are leading us to certain deeds that are not true to our nature, to our true self, and what we can do as an individual soul. So that's really where the magic is. And when that intuition is awake, it's just like anything, you know, if you don't use it, you lose it. And a lot of people, it's gone. Like it's literally just, it's not there. So we need to spark that, you know, intuition, boom, whether it's raw foods, whether it's meditation, whether, you know, I don't care. It's like, just get that thing going and start listening to yourself and believing in yourself. Have that faith. You know, energetically, I get it, because people are just living in the first two chakras. That's it. You know, survival, procreation, and then boom, right back down. That's it. You know, there's no chance to get into that creative power center or get into your heart and unconditionally love everybody or speak your truth in your throat because you're so afraid of losing your job or whatever. You know, like we're just in this fear-based paradigm, man. And it's like, you got to flip that switch to create actions from your heart, from your love. And I really have nothing to lose at the end of the day. You know, when you have that attitude, I think people, again, are just living by fear. Like, oh, I don't want to lose my house or my job or this or that. It's like, I lost my health. I lost everything. I've done it, you know? So it's like, I got nothing to lose. And it's something that I'm just excited, again, to share these protocols and stuff with people, because it's something that we really need. And I think people are ready for it. And I think they are.
Yeah. Well, I think it's easy to fall into that victim mentality, right? Like the world's against me, everything's against me, and then come up with excuses or what have you. And, you know, it's that story that you keep, that negative story you keep repeating in your head, and eventually that becomes your reality.
Yes.
I think when people realize everything that you're experiencing in this world is a direct reflection of your internal environment, right? So, you know, you're creating what you see, what you experience. So it's a matter of changing your mindset and then creating, manifesting the world that you want to see, want to experience. But that, again, that's hard with the propaganda, the conditioning, and all that stuff. So it's, you really, you got to awaken yourself, and that's hard to do. But
you do. It's hard because of our environment. That's one thing I want to stress right now, because people, I've learned, I don't blame anybody. I see that spark, that soul in everyone's heart. The darkest, the dark, ex-vegan, carnivore, whatever, or even like the police or the president, the politicians, you know, the people in Monsanto, who, they're human beings. We are one. There is a soul. There's a spark in that individual. And I see that in everybody. What do I blame though? Right now, what we're talking about, I blame the environment. I blame our environment keeping us trapped in that toxicity that you're talking about. And for me, I freed myself from that environment by living in Alaska. So, you know, I've been going up there since 2011. And when you have to drive, you know, 3 hours to go to a grocery store, it's like your whole life changes. Your whole priorities change. You know?
Right.
You're foraging berries, you're learning what nature is, you're living in tune with the rhythms of earth. And it's something that people, like I said, are really desperate for that right now, because their environment is controlling their neurochemistry, the dopamine from the phones to the EMF from the 5G. I mean, don't even get me started. It's crazy. This, you know, artificial world we're living in. And the craziest part now is it's invisible. It went from, you know, chemtrails and things that we could obviously see to this new wave of invisible warfare that is straight up controlling us. And it's something that our own minds are, you know, addicted to it. So it's like, you know, from inside out, it's not from the outside anymore. So I got to hand it to them at the end of the day. You know, these are human beings that created this, you know, and that are doing this to us. It's not some alien or whatever, right? So it's like, good job, man. You really did it, man. Because it's like, we're hooked. And the saddest part in my own family, right? I'm the black sheep. Nobody does what I do in my family, right? I feel I'm very radical and I'm very extreme to my family. And I love them and they love me. It's very unconditional. I'm just saying it's, I get it. I get the American.
Oh, yeah.
It's very toxic, and it's every day I see, you know, more inflammation and more things. It's honestly so hard to not, you know, walk by them, and I can see their eyes and I can see things that I want to tell them, you know, but I just don't have the heart to tell them unless they ask, right? I've learned to not be the vegan police and walk up and be like, you know, your colon is back. Oh, looks like your left kidney. Oh, actually, you really, oh my God, please, mom, you really need to do this. Like, I can't do that anymore. I can't be that person that picks and parts and bursts all these bubbles. You know, I can't do that. So it's been fun. Honestly, it's been fun to see this whole progress, because without my meditation practice and that observer, you know, witness mode that I can really see myself and my struggles, this is all for myself. Like, I'm learning so much about reality and the true nature of the universe through every single experience. And it, you know, even this podcast and different things, like, people are ready for this, you know, people are waking up and it's just exciting. Yeah.
Well, backing it up a little bit. So what was your introduction to meditation? So, you know, you're young, you're not doing well, your digestion, all that stuff. So how'd you get into meditation and yoga and all that stuff? Like the raw foods, like what was your introduction to all that stuff?
Yeah, so it was college. So I took that yoga and meditation. So I was just in college, just experimenting. I was actually really into music. I still am. And I play, you know, guitar and drums and things. And it's one of those things where I was basically looking to be like a producer, like a music recording guy, you know. And I was basically, 2 years into that. And I just took a yoga class, like just casually, you know. And there was a yoga and meditation class back to back. So it was like 6 units, and I just did that class. And honestly, I was just in it to, you know, I couldn't even touch my toes or do anything. I just wanted to be more flexible and to be healthy. And of course, there was attractive girls going to the class, and I wanted to be around these beautiful women and all this stuff. You know, I had very, you know, shallow reasons, of course. And anyways, that class really awakened my spirit. Yes. I took that class 4 times in a row. I literally dropped all the recording stuff. I just played music on the side, and I focused on yoga and I focused on meditation. The 4 semesters is how long the, you know, university lets you take it. The college lets you take it. So it's like, I actually, you know, messaged her on the side, and she let me come to her class on the 5th semester without even enrolling to the class. You know, I just showed up. She's my meditation and yoga teacher, Bhavani, and tied into the Yogananda Self-Realization Fellowship. So that's where I got my lineage, and that's where I got the connect. And I just really haven't looked back since. It's one of those things where my entire life changed because I really harnessed these abilities to meditate and get this perspective on life that I call the cosmic view. You know, we have these world, you know, problems, like you're talking about the victim mentality, right? That's what I would call the small self or the ego. And it's something that, you know, we got to get into that higher self, that cosmic perspective where you see this whole world like a puzzle, and there's just pieces, you know, and we're just one of those pieces in this puzzle. So I'm very excited because it was 4 semesters. I did the 5th one that technically wasn't a part of, you know, enrollment, but I did the class. class. And then I did her yoga certification. That was about a 6 month long, 200 hour credible certification and meditation class. And then I lived and actually went to live in temples. So I lived in the Hare Krishna temple in Utah.
Oh, nice. Nice.
Yeah. So that, like I said, that really sparked, like I said, looking back, I was like this young rebel kid, just really mad at life because of all the things that I was figuring out, whether it was the government stuff and blah, blah, blah. And I really wanted to just channel my energy within, because I learned that the outside world, I couldn't really affect. And what I realized is I needed to channel that energy within. And like we already said earlier, it's a reflection. So my world on the outside just blossomed because I learned how to channel my energy within and figure out this voice within me and these guides. And it's something that everyone has that ability. And I am so grateful because yoga and meditation changed my life. And then I actually honed in on just meditation in particular, because that is really what the true yoga path is. You know, especially in India, you know, recently even women were just allowed to, you know, practice. It's one of those things here in the West, we just get everything so backwards, you know. It's something, again, it's here, it's very surface level and artificial and stretching, and that, which is a part of it. The asana practice is very much a part of it. It's just, it's like maybe 10%, you know, it's not really the whole thing. So that's kind of where I feel my calling there is, to kind of circle back to the true yoga. And that's why I wrote the book, you know, The Real Yoga.
The Real Yoga, yeah.
Something that people, I think, need to hone in on to really, again, practice every day. And whether, you know, I'm certified in what's called Raja Yoga, but it's the book is about many different paths, and it's yoga is a very wide range. And that's what I love about it. It's really just tapping in to wherever you feel calling to. If you're a very active, flexible person, then you would really like Hatha yoga. If you're very intellectual, then you want to just figure out life through books and knowledge, then you're a Jnana yogi. You know, if you're a heart person and you just love life and you want to sing, then you're a Bhakti yogi. You know, so it's just about whatever resonates with you. And so what I did is I just traveled and I went and I did it all. And that was when I was 18, and I literally didn't get out of California at all until I was 18 years old, and just went from there. I was living in my 1970 Volkswagen bus for a while and traveling through that. And this is before van life and before all that stuff too. Looking back, man, I really miss that bus, because I love mechanics and I love working on stuff, and I just worked on, I replaced so many things in that bus, and I learned so much about life just traveling, you know, without a phone. I feel so old talking right now, by the way, too. Without a phone, without life, like going getting gas and about, like, just looking how much we use technology now and how much it overrides our day-to-day life just really blows my mind. It truly does. So I'm very thankful, because I think I'm the last generation to kind of see that before and after. You know, I didn't grow up with a phone or anything, so it's one of those things where it's just interesting to kind of watch it in my nieces and nephews literally, you know, coat their brains in this, you know, dopamine rich, you know, it's just changing the chemistry all together. So it's really interesting to observe and watch, and not just, like, you know, really get on them for it. You know what I mean? Because that's not the answer either. It's something that's approach, you know? So yeah, I love yoga. I love meditation. I think, again, with this health and this vegan community, I was, you know, I just want to really bring that calling, because that's why I created the Infinite Cup, with spirituality meets health and wellness, because I think people, you know, are missing that component in this health and wellness, you know, vegan community. Because yes, people are going vegan and stuff more than ever. I did it for health, compassionate, empathy, you know, reasons, and I haven't. Right. 12 plus years ago now. I mean, I did it very just weird too. You know, I mean, I cut out dairy and I cut out thing. And I was having, like, cause I was in Alaska. I remember the last thing I had was some salmon in Alaska and stuff like that. It's just really interesting how much, like I said, people circle back, and it's like, we can't reinvent the wheel here, people. The fruits and vegetables are just, it's it. It's like, I'm sorry. Yeah. And as farmer, I learned so much, because where you're competing with, like, Safeway and these bigger, you know, stores that an Amazon now, oh my God, it's like, it's really much, it's really hard for the small farmer in this equation. So it's interesting what's happened to our food and our value systems, you know, as a society and as a community. So it just comes circling back to just environment, right? Cause I knew that reading, you know, Autobiography Yogi, that was probably the biggest, catalyst for my journey. Yeah. All right.
It has taken me so long to get through this book, though.
Yes.
Sometimes it's a little slow. Sometimes it's good, but it's taken me a while, but I'm trying.
Yeah. Oh, you got it, man. That's like a Bible to me, man. I've read that countless times and I have it on audiobook for me. I just play it all the time. I could, like, it's seriously just life-changing for me because it sparked so many things within me. And yes, so that right there is really where the, you know, energy and the focus needs to be maintained, right? And this ability that we have in this lifetime right now to wake up, I mean, is precious. So it's like, again, I don't have time to deal with if you want to eat animals or what, that's cool. I have no judgments or whatever. It's just, I want to focus my energy on the people that are really, their hearts are already open. They're already ready for this information, you know? So I look at it as an evolution of the soul, and it's kind of like you just pick up where you left off, and it's like, are you ready to, you know, just do the dance? Yeah. Like, what are you really trying to cultivate in this life? What are you really doing? And that's what, you know, was my motivation to traveling to Alaska and these places where I was just honestly looking for real food and real, real people and experiences. Oh, yeah. You know? And that's where I'm on even right now. That's kind of, like I said, something that I do every day as far as when I think about where I want to travel or what do I want to do in life, because it's something that motivates me every single day. Yeah.
Now, does meditation and yoga have to be a daily practice to be effective? Because I go through patches where I can be consistent for a little bit and then I get lazy and I forget. So there's still benefit to it.
Of course. Yes, of course. 100%. And I would say this, consistency is key. So like 5 minutes a day is much better than like 30 minutes once a week.
See what I mean? Right. Yeah.
So what you're doing is you're training the subconscious brain. The subconscious brain is pretty much what makes all the decisions in most people, because they're not conscious. They're not making conscious decisions, you know? And it's something where I was in that same boat, and I'll tell you a story that threw me over the edge. I can honestly tell you, okay, I was certified in 2011. I was going up to Alaska. It wasn't until 2013. To where it was like, boom, an everyday practice for me, like without a doubt, can't even not do it. And it was because I was in Alaska and I was meditating. And like you, I was like, you know, very sporadic, and it wasn't consistent because I had a heavy work schedule and certain things. So I was just having a very casual meditation. And for the first time in my whole life, I heard that cosmic vibration, ohm, you know, within me, like not just like playing an audio tape, not just, I'm talking about like that pure ecstasy, that pure bliss, like audible sounds within me resonating my whole body, right? Like whatever you think is bliss and you've gotten it from an active, got it for the first time with no stimulus whatsoever. And from that moment on, I was changed. And what's crazy though is it does help my situation, but what it honestly did is like create expectations. See, it almost made it worse, because now when I sit and meditate, I'm like, oh, I'm gonna be super blissed out and it's gonna be wonderful. And worse, because if you have expectations, then you're going to create even more attachments and you're going to suffer. Even that's like Buddhism 101,
right?
You know? So it's like, it's one of those things where the answer to your question is basically just like the health thing. That body awareness that we have doesn't stop. So that body awareness and intelligence will override the small self. And that's exactly what happens. Your small self is like, oh, meditation is not a big deal, whatever, blah, blah. And it's like that experience that you have is simply going to, you know, overweigh that. But my favorite mantra in the whole wide world is the universe always gives you what you want. You can't mess with free will. You just can't. Yeah. So, you know, I always look at that cosmic view, you know, and like I said, God or Krishna, whoever you want to, is like constantly pouring this love and energy into you and just wants you to be happy. So if you don't want to meditate, then don't meditate. It's cool, bro. Just chill out, you know?
Yeah. Well, how'd you get into the raw foods? What was the leap to that? You started following someone on social media, or because mine was Dan McDonald. Like I looked up wheatgrass on YouTube, and then there was Dan, and that led me to raw foods, detoxification, Dr. Morse, and that just opened the floodgates. And
yep, me too, brother. Me too, 100%. And we actually have a lot of personal things, you know, real life things that I want to get into in this podcast, because it's not appropriate. It's just we know each other. I love Dan. He's amazing. And yeah, it's kind of funny. Okay, I can tell you the small story with that. So I got after the farm, and then I got a job at Whole Foods. I circled back my first winter back here in California, and because my little niece was being born, I wanted to be a part of her life. So I got a job at Whole Foods while my niece was being born, so I can stay close to the family. And let's see, it was like a year, almost a year working at Whole Foods. I'm help raising my niece. She's getting big. I'm just loving life. And guess who comes strolling into Whole Foods, right? I'm in the produce department, of course. I've always worked in produce my whole life. And yeah, this was like, yeah, I've probably been vegan for, I don't know how long. I'm not the guy that keeps track and stuff, you know, but I've been watching his videos for a while. And the reason why I resonate with Dan, again, because he's the only one back then that was talking about spirituality and meditation and yoga and stuff. He, very much, in my opinion, has a spiritual approach, you know, and I love Dan for that. And that's where we really resonate together. And, you know, my hair was up, you know, my dreads were up on my head and I was in my uniform and stuff. And he comes strolling out like, I was just shook, like, I didn't know what to do. And it's funny because it was one of those things where the real life and the, you know, the person in your head kind of collide, you know. That happened first, but what's really funny is I'm an empath. I'm a very energetic, sensitive person. I'm an energy reader. I can see auras and the whole bit. And what's funny is looking back. So Dan was on a fast. He was on honestly like day 20 something of a fast. And right when he entered the produce department, like opened the doors and I locked eyes and I read his energy, I had this instant like, oh, like I felt his stomach pain. You see what I mean? Because I don't, you know, you've probably done some long fasting too. I like when you get, you know, days in like that, it gets, you know, you're grinding and it's like, you really have this internal, you know, fire going on. And I felt that in the room and I was like, whoa, it just hit me so hard, like a bullet, you know, and I kind of had to breathe and like help him out energetically. And then we came up and hugged and just had this connection that, you know, totally, you know, led us to future things. And it's awesome looking back. And that was only probably about a year of my life going down that rabbit hole. But to be honest, and it's nothing against Dan or any buddy on those. There's a few other people. I don't want to mention any names here, but that's really the catalyst that turned me off from raw foods as well, because I was around some other, not Dan, but around some other people who very much were like, oh, he eats cooked food still? Oh my God. Like,
yeah. What?
Yeah. Like literally word for word like that. Okay. And I felt so much judgment from this person, you know, and I was like, wow, I don't want anything to do with that. And so I made the mistake of like, you know, partnering raw foods with that judgment in the beginning. And I was kind of against it, you know?
Yeah.
And what I did was I did my own experiments. Yeah. So I definitely went down the rabbit hole and very much was just raw foodist for a long time and basically figured out that fruit was the magic. And then I was on exclusive fruit for a long time and doing intense fasting and enemas, colonics, the whole bit. Yeah. And I really dove deep into myself and I'm very thankful for that. But again, it's kind of like an ebb and flow because that's not where the money is 100%. You know, it's like you can do all the colonics in the world and have the best juicer and the best source to organic, you know, vegetables you can want, and it's still not enough, to be honest. So I think, again, the magic is, you know, your spiritual practice, you know, something that really just connects you with that higher source, whatever that is. Like, I really don't care even giving it a label at this point, because I'm just tired of all labels, really, especially right now with this drama. You know, it's something that I think people, again, get attached to these things, just like I did. I fell for it. I idolized Dan, and I idolized these people. And, you know, I met him in person. We're hanging out. We're doing these things. And it's one of those things where, fast forward. It's like I fell for that trap. Yeah. And I felt great off fruit. I still do. I love fruit. Nothing against fruit. You know, it's not about that. It's that the ego. It's the small self that just wants to win the game all the time, you know?
Yeah.
So if you don't have that mind in control, it's going to just be it's going to master your life, and you need to really get your priorities straight, you know? And I can remember the day it happened, man. There was so much pressure on me, and I felt I honestly gave myself so much guilt for eating like a potato, you know? Like, so many times, like, I just guilt trip myself for eating a potato, and I would have vivid dreams about potatoes, spaghetti, not like junk food. I'm not this person that wants to go binge or whatever. I've never had that like addictive personality. It's just funny how, again, looking back, my intuition was like screaming at me, yelling at me, like, dude, eat some potatoes right now. Like, just eat some potatoes. And my ego was like, no, I'm a fruitarian, bro. I don't do that anymore. I don't really eat that stuff, you know? And it, this battle, this internal battle within me, you know? So again, at the end of the day, it's just listening to your intuition, staying in line with what makes you feel good. Yes, I eat some potatoes and they make me feel good. Yeah. And it's awesome. And it's one of those things where it's just circling back to balance. It's not for everybody. And I think a lot of people just get confused. And my favorite word with the whole raw food thing or fruitarian thing is I love the word prescription, in the sense of let's prescribe that, you know, for 30 days, for 40 days, 50 days or whatever, you know, but to get into this mentality where you're like, I'm going to do this and this is what I do forever. And well, it just sets you up for failure, in my opinion, because it creates attachment. That's again, Buddhism 101. It's like When you attach to your identity, you're going to suffer. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I was the same way. When I first started, I was, you know, the preachy guy, and I'm like, eat fruit, you know, be a fruitarian, and no supplements. You can't take supplements because that's not nature. Nature doesn't do that, you know. It's completely just dogmatic and militant about things. And over the years, I'm slowly just getting more in balance with myself and not following what other people are doing, trying to emulate their lifestyle. Because I get on social media and someone's like, oh, I'm starting a 40-day juice cleanse. I'm like, well, shit, I need to do that too. And then I'm doing what they're doing, not being intuitive at all to what I need, but it looks good to them. And I try and live their lifestyle. Like my whole, when I first found Dan, I'm like, well, shit, I got to be exactly what he's at. He's been doing it for years. And I'm trying to jump right into his lifestyle. It didn't work. It backfired, of course. So yeah, just get more intuitive to what you need at your level, where you're at. So,
and also I want to make this, yes, 100%, but also escape duality. Okay. That's really the message here. Meaning like, it's not a one approach, you know, it doesn't work like that, you know?
Yeah.
And I really don't like this pyramid that we've built of like, okay, even, you know, we can start at veganism and go, you know, whole food or plant-based, and then like raw food, and then like fruitarian, then like breatharian. But like, I don't like the fact that that's a pyramid admits that it's duality, that there's a, you know, an ebb and flow. And that's what we're here to transcend. See, that's what meditation is all about. And that's what I mean. It's not about any of those things. Yes, at the same time, fruit is amazing. Yes, you need to breathe consciously and meditate. And yes, whole foods are amazing. You know what I mean? So it's like, it's hard. Don't get, you know, caught up in my words. It's just interesting how, like I said, we get caught in that. And when I went down that rabbit hole into these elite people, in my opinion, they were very elite and very doing things that I would call elite in the sense of not the average person can do or afford those things. So I was just very off put by all of that. And I was like, this is not for me. So I'm going to go back to, you know, what I do best. And it's just to circle back to my people, and not to create like an us versus them at all. Again, I don't want to get into duality, you know, we're all one and we're all on this path together. And just that judgment and that self-hate, you know, that we constantly put on ourselves is ridiculous. And like you're saying, it's such a, you know, stimulating world. You're flipping through, you see somebody that looks great and you want their light because he's all vibrant and you just want it. You know, that's what we do. And it's great. The question is though, is that the best thing for you at that particular time? That's a whole nother conversation that just needs to happen. And I think people just get lost in that, and that real, you know, identity and what they're doing, because I've seen it time and time again. So I'm very thankful again, just for the meditation practice, because I'm looking back, without that, if I wasn't meditating or doing anything, I would have been just roller coasting too. And I'd probably be a biohacker or something now. Red light therapy or whatever, you know, it's like all that stuff is great, it's cool, it's like, yeah, I get it. But it's like, when you're just going from trend to trend to trend, it's proof that you don't have your own, you know, foundation that you, for yourself, you know, as an individual.
Yeah. Well, how does Robert today navigate making some unhealthy choices? Do you avoid the shame spiral? Do you, if you're gonna eat something unhealthy, do you just say a blessing over the food, like, hey, I know this isn't great for me, but I'm not gonna sit here and stress about it?
Exactly, 100%. Yeah. I love it. And to be honest, let's see, I'm trying to think of the most recent thing. There's like a little, it's like a ice cream type place. We get some non-dairy ice cream every once in a while. And what it is, the way I look at that, okay, is it's an inner child thing. Okay. What it is, well, in the past, I learned this through fasting, through, you know, especially the raw vegan fruitarian phase, is I was repressing energy. Okay. This is energy that people do, and all food is tied to emotions. So for me, I grew up on pastries. My dad, my biological father, and I had the same exact name, same exact birthday. Me and him were like this. Oh, wow. And he left the body when I was 11 years old. So I have a lot of happy memories with him, of him giving me, you know, chocolate chip muffins, cinnamon rolls, you know, all donuts and things. And that sugar just made me feel so happy. And I connected it with my dad, who I don't have anymore in this body, in this life, you see. So you have to understand what's happening on the emotional level. And that's where, you know, the holistic approach here, you know, that I, you know, come from is really where I think it needs to be. Because yes, the physical, you need minerals, your body needs minerals, the enzymes are not going to come from the food and all the spiel of raw foods. Yes, I get it. Now, are you addressing your emotions though? Are you addressing, you know, the spiritual progress and things that, you know, there's other layers in our human form that are not, you know, being addressed. So
yeah, I always say you got the best diet in the world, but if mentally you're in a bad place, it's not going to make a difference. You're going to get sick.
You're going to get sick. And I love, and that's really, I can't thank you enough for saying that, because that's really where it's at. And I've learned that, and they've tested it, you know, 15 seconds, you can go, it's acidic, just boom. So like they've tested it by just somebody, you know, relaxing, and then you just scare them even, you know, just like come up and give them a little joke.
Yeah.
And boom. 15 seconds. Now we have that by our phones, you know, 24/7, you know, and things with notifications. I don't have any notifications on my phone for that reason. I'm not going to let my phone tell me when to pull my energy out of my field.
See, yeah, good point. Good point. Yeah.
It's something like that where I made that choice. I have no notifications because I make that choice when I want to stroll in and look at my phone and be subject to that information. And it's something where, again, we're just, our environment is something we can control. A lot of people in that victim mentality that are listening to my words right now, you can control everything as soon as you change your environment, because that's what I blame, again, because people are not in the right environment to thrive, you know? And if, you know, we easily blame ourselves for whatever problem, and if you just take out that and just replace it with the environment, I think you're going to have some traction there, you know? So for me, it's great. And, you know, to answer your question more specifically with the inner child work and the sweets and stuff. So with me, I still crave that very much, like that soft, you know, I'm a chef too, right? So I love all this, you know, I'm a big foodie and I love being in the kitchen for hours and I can just make stuff. So, I understand what it requires. Like, okay, for example, we can just talk about gluten for like 10 hours. You know what I mean? It's like one of those things where, that texture of, you know, pizza and bread, and so it's such a crazy thing that we're addicted to. And I understand that, you know? So yes, I try to recreate it in a, you know, gluten-free, amazing way, but it's never going to be the same as that, you know, original pizza or whatever. Sure. You can get close and, you know, be optimistic about it, you know, but that's why my gourmet raw vegan phase didn't last long, you know, with the dehydrators and stuff, man, because I love it. Trust me, I love it. I could eat it, but it's like, I just don't have that time. You know what I mean? I'm just going to eat some fruit and have my smoothie and I'm good. You know, I just don't really, I can't do the gourmet raw stuff anymore. Like, it's just one of those things where I went through that phase and honestly, my digestion got worse probably through all of that.
Yeah.
Way too many nuts and seeds and way too many, just things that I was excited about, you know, like raw pizza and things, and it all sounds fun and great, but it's just like, nah, I'm good. I'd rather just, you know, stick to my things. And then, like I said, if my inner child really starts calling out to me, like, you know, feed me, Robert, feed me this thing, I'll do it. And no, I won't obviously eat meat or dairy or whatever, but I will go out. And like I said, the closest example I can think of is, what's it called? It's called 21 Choices. It's this, just like a non-dairy frozen yogurt type place, you know, and they have two non-dairy options. So I'm like, cool, I'll go in there with my fiance and we'll have a good time and create happy memories around this amazing ice cream experience, you see. But the old Robert, no, he would have gave himself shit the whole time, every freaking bite, you know what I mean? So I've learned to love the process. If you know if you're still eating the Oreos or whatever it is, just love yourself through that process, and that's really going to speed up, you know, the evolution of your goals, whether it's weight loss or, you know, energy and stuff like that.
Yeah, it gets tricky when you start to have a family and you have kids. I try and be a good example for my kids, but I'm not super dogmatic with them, or, you know, so I try and do the best I can with them, but I don't want to be that the asshole on Halloween who's not letting his kids go trick-or-treating because I don't want them to eat candy or something like that, you know. I don't want to be that guy. So I'm like, you know, people are that way, they're like, oh, my kid doesn't go trick-or-treating, but I'm like, I have wonderful memories trick-or-treating when I was a kid. I want my kids to have that too, but as long as they know this isn't healthy, don't do it all the time. But
Great example. Great example. And I have friends like that. I have hardcore raw vegan fruitarian friends.
Well, that's great. I mean, that's nothing wrong with that. But
yeah, I could tell you a story of, you know, when her son brought home Starbucks. You know what I mean? And it's like shit hit the fan, you know?
What?
Yeah. You see what I mean? It's like that energy is on both ways. Like I grew up very standard American and fast food, you know, French, what are those called? The French toast sticks were like my, you know, breakfast and stuff like that. So it's like, I understand that, but it's like, you know, you got to flip the coin too. And if you grow up raw vegan and do all these things, and like your kid's gonna, you know, be in the real world and they're gonna understand, you know, what Starbucks is or whatever. And it's like, they're gonna bring that home. It happened in Alaska too, because I've seen this in Alaska where people live very natural, you know, in tune with the earth. They have gardens, they hunt, they fish. They're just doing a very natural life, you know?
Yeah.
And a very similar story. And the daughter brought home Pop-Tarts, went over to her friend's house, brought home Pop-Tarts, and Pop-Tarts were not allowed in that house. And she had to hide them under her pillow. See what I mean? Like we're talking about Pop-Tarts, people, Pop-Tarts. See what I mean? It's like all that energy. Yes, Pop-Tarts are bad, whatever. It's just like, but if you're creating all that energy, it's like that non-physical thing that's making your body acidic, that's putting your system, you know, taxation on your adrenal glands, a taxation on your lymphatics. You see what I mean? Like it's addressing everything, not just on the physical. So yeah, it's huge.
It's creating an eating disorder too, is what it's doing. That's huge in this community, this lifestyle, it's eating disorders.
I fell for it 100%. I had 100%. And it's because I don't want to blame anybody. It's just, I have that personality where I'm passionate and I love it.
Yeah, me too.
So yes, I know every chemical I'm exposed to. And it's like, you know, oh, man, it's a daily practice. That's all I got to say, because I could easily get, angry and let my temple be affected by what's happening out there. But I choose not to. And I circle back to my practice and what I do on the day to day. But at the same time, yes, that means I am consuming more heavy metal detox smoothies and I am consuming more. I have to definitely ramp up my protocols depending on the environment that I'm in. That's why I'd rather just live in Alaska or Hawaii or somewhere, you know, where it's just where humans are still haven't contaminated it as much, you know? So it's like, that's kind of my value system right now that, you know, we're working towards. And my ideal thing is actually to have a retreat center to bring people to, because that's where it was for me. The story, I don't think I answered it for the raw foods in particular. It wasn't Dan. It wasn't any of that. It was, so Paramahansa Yogananda has a, there's three things. One is Self-Realization Fellowship. One is called Ananda. And there's another one called Polestar. They're just like temples, you know? Mm. And Polestar is on the Big Island of Hawaii. So I live there. And that was my first real, like every day we walk in the gardens and pick the greens and make the green juice, make smoothies from, I'd literally grab the coconuts right there, come in. So that was like my first time in my whole life. I went there. Yeah, it was 2012. I went there in 2012. So that was my big catalyst from just, hey, I'm vegan, healthy, whatever, to like, okay, now I'm just like, oh, not 100% raw, whatever. That dogma didn't get me yet. But you know what I mean? That was my huge awakening there, because I definitely, my body felt so good from green juice and just smoothies and just meditating every single day and having that discipline, because I was in the environment where I was supported. Everyone in that house in the temple, there was one of the eight people that lived with us in that temple at the time, and everyone meditated at 5 a.m. Everyone was in the garden by 7 a.m. working. Everyone had, you know, an idea for a recipe for lunch for fresh guacamole and was contributing. I mean, so the power of environment, oh my gosh, is
huge.
Yes.
Yeah, I agree. Man, we got to start wrapping this up. Why don't we conclude by talking about your new book that you just launched, The Real Yoga. What inspired that, and what's the book about?
The Real Yoga is about, oh man, so basically now that I've let's see, it's been almost 2 years, I think, since I've created the Infinite Cup and just got, you know, digital and getting real into the world here. And I get a lot of questions and I help people and I do coaching and it's wonderful. It's just one of those things where I feel, again, like I ask myself a question, like what can I provide to the world, to the community that is going to help the most? I just want to help others. I want to really, impact lives in the sense of creating that change and transformation. So for me, it was yoga and meditation. And yes, I could write some, you know, recipe book or something, but it's something where at the end of the day, meditation is really where the magic is. And if people had a daily practice and their intuition was on and they were guided, and I think that's what I have my faith in 100%. So I wanted to instill my energy in that. And again, I'm the guy, like, I had no phone and stuff. So it's been over 2 years almost, you know, since I had that idea to manifest it into a physical book finally. Thank God, you know, for Fiverr and people on digital world to help me out, you know, because I've done a lot of you know, just diving deep into this digital world of editing and craziness, and I'm very much like an off-grid type of, you know, simple guy. So it's been quite the challenge, but it's totally worth it. I'm excited. So yeah, the book is pretty much an idealistic, you know, 108 pages simple approach to create a home practice. You know, I want people to just read this book and be like, yes, I have confidence now that this is the type of yoga that I want to do. This is how I'm going to meditate. And it's also a reference, you know, it's something you can look back on with yoga poses and a very, you know, simple outline on all yogic practices, true yoga practices that hopefully will resonate with you. So you can pick one and just practice and just try it out, you know, because that's where I was at. And I think people just really need that foundation. So I'm just, yeah, really excited to have that in a physical, you know, something in the material world. It's just awesome.
right on. So did you self-publish it, or did you go through a publisher, or how?
Self-published it. Yep, 100%. Nice. It's on Amazon right now. Super excited, just like I said, to have all those steps, you know, in motion, because I feel like it's been over 2 years, yeah, of me from the idea to writing, editing, all this stuff, and it's just like crazy to me. So it's just fun to see it all happen. And
Yeah,
I'm excited for people to hopefully resonate with the message. And people, I know at the end of the day, like you're saying, we all have that, you know, priority thing, whether it's our job or kids or energy and stuff like that. But once you recognize we are true, you know, spirit, we're true spirit soul. I am not this body. I am not my thoughts. I am not, like, that realization, you know, once that light switch turns on, you really can't go back. And that's my intention at the end of the day, is to really help, you know, promote and guide that message to as many people as possible.
Awesome, man. I love that. Yeah. I'm the same way. I love creating content, but sometimes I get too many things spinning in the air, and then I do a little bit here, a little bit here, and then I get nothing done. So sometimes I need to just focus on one thing and just finish it. I got so many projects. Yeah.
I'm right there with you, man. I have so many projects still that I'm very excited about, but this, just to see one thing come to completion is
yeah.
It's huge. So I'm just, yeah, excited to share it with everybody. And it's just exciting to see it all happen. Yeah.
Okay. So I'll get some links from you, and I'll put some links down in the show notes, and then so people can get that on Amazon, right?
Yeah. Yep. That's the best way, easiest way. That's the other thing too, man. I, in the beginning, I totally fought the Amazon thing, and I realized you got to use these vehicles for people. I've spent so much energy like going against it and stuff that I realized people, like with creating my infinite cup, I remember the conversation that happened, my friend Justin, and I was complaining to him. I was like, yeah, Facebook is watching us. The man's always watching us. They can see us, blah, blah. And he's like, you know, they're just watching everything you do. So you might as well just put a positive message out there. Yeah, that's all he said. That's it. And I was like, that hit me so hard. And I was like, you're right. I need to get over my own shit, my own stuff. And that's what I did. I literally wrote it all down. Like, I'm still, you know, camera shy and stuff when I make videos. It's like, I literally wrote all this stuff down. And looking back to my first videos, I re-scripted and I wrote it. That's gotta be perfect. And blah, blah, blah. Like, my evolution has been insane when it comes to my digital, you know, content and stuff. So it's just been really fun kind of witnessing it all, because again, at the end of the day, this is a daily practice. You know, nobody's perfect. Nobody, you know, we're all aspiring to many things. So it's just fun. And whatever tools that we have to help each other out, the more power to you, you know, that's really what the message is at the end of the day.
Yeah. Well, I think you're expecting a child here soon, right? So
yeah, so excited. Yes. Yeah.
So
33 weeks pregnant. We are so excited. And this is, yeah, my real opportunity, right? To like, looking back, oh my gosh, starting out vegetarian, vegan, starting out, like being able to just eat fruits and have such an abundant, like, I can't imagine that, what could it do to a child. And just like, I'm looking at, you know, 10, 15 years from now, you know, I'm like, wow, this carnivore thing, this, you know, ex-vegan thing, whatever, this is nothing compared to what's going to, I seriously have this vision that is so, you know, beautiful that people, you just can't stop it. You know, it's something that we're all tapped into it and we're all seeing it happen right now. So it's only a matter of time. And once, you know, you drop those trends and you stop believing those waves, those artificial waves, it's like, it's really easy. It's clear. It's right there in front of you. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's great what you're doing. And what I'm doing too, is I realized, well, I'm creating a library of content that my kids one day, when they get interested, will have access to. Say, hey, oh, my dad was the crazy guy into this stuff. So let's see what he was doing. Cause eventually they're going to get the download and the awakening too. So you're just creating content for your future kids, your grandkids. So
100%. Yeah, I love it. And that's exactly what we're doing. This is the natural, sustainable approach. I don't think people are looking long-term. That's like my favorite tagline, you know, natural and sustainable, because at the end of the day, if you have that mindfulness, that level of mindfulness, you know, with the water, with your actions, with everything that you do, then you're good. There is no karma. There is no exchange. There's no toxicity at all. You know, you can live life in homeostasis and just in harmony. You know, and I think people, you know, that's our potential, you know? So it's, I see people living like 10, you know, 5% of that potential. And it just frustrates me. It honestly frustrates me. And it's like, I just want to shake them and just like, come on. It's like, don't you understand? Like, just have some juice here. Just drink this, you know?
Yeah. Oh, you do what you can, man.
Yeah.
If people want to connect with you, what's the best way, Robert?
Oh, Instagram is probably the best. You know, I'm on there a lot, but I have my website, theinfinitecup.com. Coaching sessions are always available. I'm going to do signed copies of my book. If you want a signed copy, just, you know, direct message me on social media. I got a lot of people requesting some signed copies, so I want to do that for as many people as I can. And yeah, just connect with me on social media, Instagram, Facebook, the whole works. Yeah, The Infinite Cup. My name is Robert Breton, and you'll find me there. And yeah, looking forward to connect.
Awesome. Sweet, man. I appreciate you giving your time today. I appreciate it.
Appreciate it, Chris. This has been awesome. You're doing great work too, brother. Keep it up, man. Really inspired by you.
Thanks. Appreciate that. All right. Thanks, everybody.